Harper Perennial and Harper Audio present Twisted, The Tangled History of Black Hair Culture by Emma Dabiri. Narrated by Emma Dabiri.
Chapter 1, It's Only Hair. It is not from my mouth. It is not from the mouth of A, who gave it to B, who gave it to C, who gave it to D, who gave it to E, who gave it to F, who gave it to me. That it be better in my mouth than in the mouth of my ancestors. West African poem. The year I turned 8, the consumption of Christ's body and blood became imminent. After months of deliberation, extravagant miniature bridal dresses had been bought. Lace, satin, and net hung expectantly in wardrobes. The communion money, which could quite reasonably be expected to stretch into the hundreds, a veritable fortune in 1980s inner-city Dublin, was the hot promise occupying everyone's thoughts. After months of slaving over the catechism, of hard work and dutiful preparation, my peers were ready to make their first Holy Communion. No catechism for this bad man, though. I had elected not to take the sacrament. Young Emma's contribution, having reached the age of reason, was instead the production of a spiffy little anti-slavery pamphlet called Break the Chains. The length of a copybook, it was based on the story of Aludo Equiano, the 18th century abolitionist. The conclusion, I remember, attempted to locate the contemporary conditions of Black America in the brutal experiences Africans had endured in that land and sought to suggest solutions, hence the title. Nice and light, standard childhood fare. While I wasn't particularly praised for my efforts, I certainly wasn't forced to join with the other children either. With hindsight, this is telling, if unsurprising. There was always the insistence that despite my being born in Ireland and having an Irish mother whose maternal ancestry stretches back into Irish prehistory, that I wasn't really Irish. I was frequently singled out for special attention. I seemed to be a firm favourite of nuns, particularly those who had been missionaries in Africa. I remember on one occasion being apprehended outside the Bird Flanagan pub in Rialto and presented with a miraculous medal by a concerned nun who wished to bestow the grace of the Virgin Mary on my little brown body. It was not the only time I was presented with one of these. I seemed to be quite the miraculous magnet. And I remember visiting a friend's elderly great aunt, another nun, whose watery eyes refocused, then blazed upon sighting me. I spent years in Nigeria, she thundered, before proceeding to pull my lips back over my teeth, because your people have such beautiful teeth. Given that this rather intimate exchange occurred before even the most basic of introductions, one might think it at the very least rude. So yeah, I had a complicated relationship with the world I lived in, and I think the fact that I embarked on the Equiano project was most likely interpreted as just the sort of weird shit that a foreigner, a blackie, might do. I mean, what do you expect from the likes of them, like? Thinking about Equiano now, my decision does seem radical. I can't remember precisely what my motivation was, but my childhood was often characterized by unusual choices and interests. Informed by a strong sense that my impulse to tell Black stories originated perhaps from a source that predated my birth. It is not from my mouth. Though it might sound peculiar, and it certainly felt strange to me, I felt intuitively that I had a working relationship with the past and with my forebears. It was as though the past happened to be particularly foregrounded in my present. Of course, I couldn't articulate this even to myself, and had I been able to, I would most likely have elected not to. As a child, I was considered strange enough, no need for further ammunition. It was only when years later I went to university and studied African cultures that I learned about the centrality of ancestral veneration, that ancestral spirits were intentionally invoked. On my paternal side, I am Yoruba. The Yoruba are the largest ethnic group in southwestern Nigeria, and the third biggest in Nigeria, Africa's most populous country. Many Yoruba were sold into slavery, particularly during the 19th century. As a result of this relatively recent wide-scale movement, many Yoruba beliefs, practices, and customs can be identified to this day throughout the New World. During the 1980s and 1990s, a more recent Yoruba diaspora was created as Nigerians fled their tragically failing economy to migrate to countries such as the US and the UK. One result of colonialism was a disregard for many Yoruba beliefs. Therefore, it was only at university that I learned that traditional Yoruba concepts of time were more cyclical and of the belief that the past is not necessarily dispensed with, but is in fact in dialogue with the future. I discovered that Yoruba names such as Babatunde, father comes again, and Yetunde, mother comes again, are so common because of an indigenous belief in the transmigration of the soul. This invocation of the past, like the Ghanaian philosophical concept Sankofa, which urges us to take from the past to design a better future, does not limit progress or place emphasis on doing things the old way. On the contrary, improvement is the objective, the urge to ensure that the mind be better in my mouth than in the mouth of my ancestors. It is believed that our successes are our great-great successes too. Finally, I could locate my experiences in a belief system where they made perfect sense. Received Western wisdom routinely denigrates African history. The attitude was summed up by the esteemed historian Hugh Trevor Roper in his famous 1963 address at Sussex University, which was broadcast on national television, as well as being published both in a popular periodical and as a book. Perhaps in the future there will be some African history to teach. But at present there is none, or very little. There is only the history of Europeans in Africa. The rest is largely darkness, like the history of pre-European, pre-Columbian America. And darkness is not a subject for history. Assessed through a biased Eurocentric framework, perhaps this is the case. Yet, if we shift the optic, we begin to realise, in the words of Nigerian Nobel laureate Wole Soyinka, that the darkness so readily attributed to the dark continent may yet prove to be nothing but the willful cataract in the eye of the beholder. And in banishing that darkness, I am far more interested in how African peoples understood themselves and their cultures, in examining their methods for telling and documenting their lives, than I am in attempting to situate them through a European lens that proposes universality but is inherently culturally specific. We should remember that communication and learning in oral society are not limited to the spoken word. Complex nonverbal languages are part of the milieu. Take, for example, the bata, or talking drum, as it is translated into English. Echoing the tonal patterns of Yoruba, the bata literally speaks. Were the British colonialists unable to decipher what the drum said, illiterate too? Or is the term one we only apply to primitive peoples? The Anglo-Ghanaian philosopher Kwame Anthony Appiah describes African hairstyling as a subtle interplay of the sociological and the aesthetic. As a practice, hairstyling has much to offer and opens up excitingly decolonized possibilities for better understanding the African past in order to shape a better collective future. In terms of my early attempts at decolonization, the freedom demonstrated by the Equiano project was sadly not to be repeated. I think it was permitted on this occasion primarily because it kept me out of the way. Until the late 1990s, being Black and Irish in Ireland was to have almost unicorn status. Except everybody loves unicorns. There has not been a significant Black population in Ireland for very long. When I was growing up, there were very few of us indeed. Many mixed-race people I met, certainly those who were any older than me, had grown up in institutions. They were often the, quote-unquote, illegitimate offspring of Irish women and African students. Not to put too fine a point on it, but unmarried mothers were generally in Ireland treated like scum. Add the disgrace of a Black child, and sure, you couldn't really sink much lower. Commenting on the mixed-race children unfortunate enough to be placed in Ireland's now infamous industrial schools, a report submitted to the Irish Department of Education had this to say in 1966. A certain number of coloured children were seen in several schools. Their future, especially in the case of girls, presents a problem difficult of any satisfactory solution. Their prospects of marriage in this country are practically nil. And their future happiness and welfare can only be assured in a country with a fair multiracial population, since they are not well received by either Black or white. The result is that these girls, on leaving the schools, mostly go to large city centres in Great Britain. It was quite apparent that the nuns give special attention to these unfortunate children, who are frequently found hot-tempered and difficult to control. The coloured boys do not present quite the same problem. It would seem that they also got special attention and that they were popular with the other boys. According to alumni of these abhorrent facilities, this special attention seems to have extended to racist assaults, which served to compound the physical, sexual, emotional, and mental abuse many of the children were subjected to. During my own school days, 20 plus years later, attitudes didn't seem to have changed that much. Yet, the Ireland emerging on the horizon today seems almost unrecognisable to me. There is now a visible Black Irish population, and in terms of social progress, in 2015 we became the first country in the world to legalise same-sex marriage by popular vote. And in 2018, following another referendum, the draconian Eighth Amendment that criminalised abortion was repealed. This seemingly kinder, more diverse Ireland is a far cry from that which defined my miserable years at school. Days when the smallest indiscretion, real or usually imagined, invoked punishment far disproportionate to the crime. And just like our tempers, my hair too was difficult to control. From my earliest memories, my hair was presented as a problem that needed to be managed. The deeply entrenched idea of managing Black women's hair operates as a powerful metaphor for societal control over our bodies at both micro and macro levels. Whether it's historic bondage during the transatlantic slave trade, or indeed the attitude of the education system, the thousands of Black women held in immigration detention centres today, or the disproportionate amount of Black women in prison, in the US, Black women are incarcerated at four times the rate of white women, our bodily autonomy cannot be assumed. Barely a month seems to go by without there being another news report about a Black child excluded from school for wearing their hair naturally. The 2016 case in Pretoria High School in South Africa was particularly shocking, not only for the violence of the altercation, but also because of the geographic location. This didn't happen in Britain or Ireland or America, but on the African continent. Protests broke out because little girls wanted to leave their hair alone. Yet, Pretoria High maintained that natural hair was messy. The administration claimed that by not straightening their hair, Black female students were not conforming to the rules regarding appropriate presentation, and protests broke out when schoolgirls simply refused to straighten their hair. As a Black child with tightly coiled hair, growing up in an incredibly white, homogenous, socially conservative Ireland, I certainly wasn't considered pretty. But that started to change in my mid-teens. I remember being told that I was lucky I was pretty, which meant I could almost get away with being Black. However, there remained the unquestioned expectation that certain measures would be taken to keep my affliction at bay. Needless to say, the most offensive manifestations of my threatening Blackness had to be rigorously policed. As I got older, my skin could almost correspond to the tan my peers were all obsessed with achieving. I still got the jokes about needing a flash to take a photograph of me or the classic likening of my complexion to dirt, but it was my hair that remained unforgivable. Anything that could be done to disguise it, to manipulate and mutilate it, was up for consideration. The concept of leaving it the way it grew from my head was simply inconceivable. There is long evidence of both weaving attachments as well as the use of wigs throughout Africa. In most Black cultures, the frequent and radical transformation of hair is typical, and the wearing of artificial hair, including wigs, is not traditionally stigmatized in the same way it is in mainstream. No, let me dispense with polite euphemisms, I mean white culture. Considering the great diversity of styles available, it is worth noting that throughout the 20th century and until recently, with the exception of the Black Power period and immediately afterwards, very few included working with Afro hair texture. Personally, I was trying to get as far away from my own texture as possible. Today I'm much freer, and now that I've embraced my natural texture, I'm also happy to rock a pink body wave wig, although I'm more likely not to. There is untold fun to be had experimenting with hair. But when I was in school, it was emphatically not about fun. My actions were a bid for assimilation by way of disguise. My efforts stemmed from a cardinal terror that people would catch sight of my real hair. From weaves to extensions, jerry curls, curly perms, and straighteners, my hair was hidden, misunderstood, damaged, broken, and completely unloved. It is hardly surprising. I never saw anybody with hair like mine. Afro hair was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.